St. Mark chapter 7. St. Mark chapter 7. We're grateful again to all of you, all of our guests. Good to have Deacon Burks with us and his family.
Amen.
Mark chapter 7, beginning at verse 31. God's holy word, because we are physically able.
Amen.
To stand that is our custom. The Bible says, then he returned, verse 31, then he returned from the region of Tyre and went through Sidon to the Sea of Galilee, in the region of Decapolis. And they brought to him a man who was deaf and had a speech impediment.
Amen.
And they begged him to lay his hand on him. And taking him aside from the crowd privately, he, Jesus, put his fingers into his ears. And after spitting, touched his tongue. And looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. Mm. And his ears were opened. His tongue was released, and he spoke plainly.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, let me read that again. Some of y'all not reading with me.
Amen.
And his ears were opened,
Lord.
And his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly.
Amen.
And Jesus charged them to tell no one, but the more he charged them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. And they were astonished beyond measure, saying, he has done all things well. Yeah. He even makes the deaf hear,
say it, preacher,
and the mute speak.
Amen.
Verse 37, and they were astonished beyond measure, saying, he has done all things well.
Yeah.
He makes the deaf hear and the mute speak.
Yeah.
Look at the person next to him and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I just want you to know,
Jesus did.
Jesus did.
Amen.
Jesus did. Thank you, ushers, musicians. Jesus did. Gospel artist Evelyn Terminator sends the songs that simply says that everything that happened to me that was good, God did it.
Hey.
Everything that happened to me that was good, God did it.
Amen. Amen.
I don't know about you, but I believe all of us in here ought to concur and be a witness to suggest that all that has happened to us in our lives, everything that has been good, everything that has been a blessing to us, you've got to admit that God did it. The truth of the matter is, I don't believe anybody in here, including myself, can really take credit for your presence here today. Maybe you are in good health, and maybe you don't have anything wrong with you, and maybe you're feeling good, and you don't have any problems, but you're still not the reason why you're sitting in the sanctuary today. The truth of the matter is, nobody in here can really take credit for why you're here and what has happened in your life. All of us in here can say that God has been good to us. All of us in here should be able to lift our hands, no matter what place in life you're at, no matter what's going on in your life, no matter how hard things may be, even now, you still ought to be able to lift your hands and say, God has been good to me. And I cannot take credit for what has happened in my life. All of the good things, everything that has happened, all of the blessings, everything that I have, everything that I am, everything that God has made me, It's not because of me. It's not because of the good I do. It's not because I've been holy, sanctified, or righteous. It's simply because God's grace and mercy has been shining in my life. Do I have anybody here who can testify that it's not you? It's not because of you. It's not your holiness or your righteousness. Or you can't take the credit. But all glory belongs to God. This thing that from last week about he keeps on keeping me. This week, I just want to tell you that Jesus did it.
Amen.
Nobody else did. Nobody else woke you up this morning. Nobody else put clothes on your back. Nobody else blessed you with food to eat. Nobody else blessed you with transportation. It wasn't your mama. It wasn't your daddy.
Amen.
I want to just look at this story real briefly. I want to look at this story about this man. This man who was deaf. This man who could not speak. He was deaf. The Bible says he was mute or he had a speech impediment. He could not speak. And when he did speak, it was not clear because he could not hear.
All right.
This man, seemingly, if you will, seemed to be minding his own business.
My Lord.
The crowd was in a frenzy because Jesus was working miracles.
Say it, Pastor, say it.
Jesus was working miracles. When we look at chapter 7 of St. Mark, we discover that Jesus had dealt with this woman's daughter.
Amen.
She was sick and Jesus healed her. Now he comes through this area and people have heard about Jesus to the degree. I want to suggest to you, the text says that some folks grabbed the deaf man.
Say it, preacher.
Grabbed him and said, come with us. And they brought him to Jesus.
My Lord.
They brought him to Jesus. These individuals, it does not let us know the deaf man's name, and it also does not let us know who brought him there. All we see is that the scripture says they brought him
Amen.
To Jesus.
Amen.
I want to suggest to you today that there are just a few things that we need to look at in this text, principles to take home with us as we discover the power of Jesus Christ. The first thing we see in the text that you can take home with is that we see the intercession of others. We see the intercession, the interceding of others. Because this deaf man who could not talk, they got him and they brought him to Jesus. The deaf man, the mute man, he was brought as if they suggest almost that they carried him to Jesus. Don't know if they carried him, but they brought him to Jesus. They knew he had a problem, and they believed that Jesus could handle what he had.
Amen.
They interceded. They heard about this power that Jesus had. This power, this woman must have testified and said, my daughter was sick. I didn't know what to do. Many of us see the problems of others and we consider it their problem. And we won't pray for people. We won't encourage nobody. We won't lift nobody up. We see people struggling. We see people going through. We see people sick. We see people having issues. And we'll sit there and look at them as if nothing is wrong. But
brought them to Jesus. They said, Jesus, lay your hands on him.
All right.
The Bible says that they begged.
Say it, preacher. Say it.
They pleaded.
Amen.
With Jesus to heal somebody else.
Hello.
Lord have mercy.
Say it, preacher.
They pleaded. They begged. They did not leave until Jesus could heal their heart. They pleaded. Please, Jesus.
Please.
Lay your hands on him.
Amen. Amen.
I need you to know what's going on. Here are some individuals begging God to work a miracle. Not for them.
Say it.
But for somebody else.
Amen.
See, a lot of us are selfish with our prayers.
Say it, Pastor. Say it.
A lot of people will tell you they're praying for you. But the truth is, there's a whole lot of people who lie to you. And everybody in here ought to have such a spirit of generosity that when you see somebody else struggling, why don't you beg God to deal with the issues in somebody else's life? They pleaded with Jesus. They begged him to lay his hands on him. I need to tell you, and don't miss it, it doesn't say it, but remember, things are said even when they're not said. Remember that these individuals must have had some type of faith to believe that Jesus could even do it.
Amen, Pastor.
Don't miss it. They must have had faith to believe that Jesus could lay his hands on this deaf man who couldn't talk. On behalf of somebody else, I gotta tell you, you gotta have faith.
All right, say it.
You gotta believe God.
Amen.
You gotta believe that God can do it.
Amen.
You gotta believe that God can work a miracle. You gotta believe that God can handle any situation.
Amen.
You couldn't hear, couldn't speak, but they believe that God's power was greater than the problem.
Amen.
They believe that God's power was greater than the problem.
Say it, preacher.
I said they believe that God's power was greater than the problem. I think I ought to help somebody today by telling you that there is no problem that causes God to be perplexed. There is no situation that God is trying to figure out up in glory. Everything you can ever let me help somebody. Let me tell you why I'm going to shout. Because that means that it's not that God can't do it. It's not that God can't heal you. It's not that God cannot deliver you. But sometimes God leaves us where we are so that we will learn that he can do it when he does do it. Let me see if I can help you.
Say it.
You wouldn't know that God could provide for you if you wasn't broke. You wouldn't know that God can bring things back together again if there's never any chaos. Sometimes God allows us to go through what we're going through so that we'll learn that his power is greater than our problem. I said God can do anything.
Yes, sir.
I said God can do anything.
Say it.
I said, God can do anything. I don't care if it's cancer, diabetes, if it's HIV, God can do anything. Migraine, headache, it doesn't matter what you have. God can do anything. There is no problem. There's no sickness. There's no issue that God can't handle. Do I have anybody here who can testify and say, Pastor, you ain't by yourself. I believe. Some storms, I've had some bad days, I've had Lord, please lay your hand on him. I believe, if I can suggest this real quick and I move on, we get out of here. I believe that some of us need to stop being upset with folk and start praying for them.
All right. Amen. Amen.
See, a lot of us have fallen prey and fallen into the trap of going back and forth with folk who are against you. But instead of going back and forth, you need to learn how to intercede on behalf of even what could be your enemy.
Amen.
What's the last time you prayed for the enemy?
Not at all.
When was the last time you got on your knees and talked to God and asked God to heal and deliver somebody who has a foul spirit?
All right.
He says they interceded. They, we see the intercession of others, but then the text not only teaches us the intercession of others, but it also teaches us the intimate care of Jesus.
Amen.
The intimate care of Jesus. Yeah. The intimate care of Jesus. This is what God means. Sister Holmes, this is what God means. That they begged Jesus to lay his hands on this man. And unlike other times, Jesus pulls this man to the side. Out of the crowd. And says, I want to deal with him by himself. Now, you read through the Gospels, you will discover that most of Jesus' healings were in public. And the crowd was there. But this one time, and this story is only recorded in Mark, this one time, Jesus pulls this man aside privately.
Amen, Beth. Amen.
Privately. And says, y'all step back for a second.
Not at all.
I want to deal with this man one-on-one.
Say it, preacher.
I need you to get this. This might be the only chance to really shout right here, because it teaches us that as big, as vast, as powerful as God is, that God also is intimate enough to deal with you by himself. Amen. Pulls him to the side, because what this man needed was different from everybody else. Jesus pulls him aside. He pulls him aside, and Jesus is looking him in his eye. The man had to feel some type of care from Jesus. That Jesus would even take the time to deal with him one-on-one. Y'all, that Jesus, the King of Kings, would literally take the time to deal with this man with deficiencies.
All right.
Pull him aside. Every time I stand here and preach, every time I stand there and teach, and every time I do anything for God, I got to tell you, I'm in awe of God, that God will literally, even me who has deficiency, God will deal with me. That's a reason to get excited, because guess what? Everybody in here has some type of deficiency. Everybody in here has something wrong with you. And yet God takes the time to speak to you and to deal with you and to be in your presence. There ought to be somebody here who lifts up to heaven and says, thank you, Lord, for when you look at me, you don't hold what is wrong with me against me. He doesn't hold it against me. He's not like some of us.
Hey.
Because some of us holds what's wrong with folk against them. The deficiency that we look at people based on what they're going through and not who they are.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
I think
I just said something right there. I said we treat people based on what they're going through, not who they are. Because who I am is not defined by what situation I'm in. The situation is temporary. It's character building. It's faith building. And so when you look at me, don't look at me with permanence. inside. The Bible says Jesus puts his finger in his ear. And then Jesus spit and then touched his tongue. Lord have mercy. This man who couldn't hear and couldn't speak. I need you to get this. Jesus assures the man by putting his finger in his ears.
Say it, preacher.
And when he spit on the ground, he touched the man's tongue. Let me show you another. Maybe you don't get excited about this, but this is crazy that Jesus here is communicating with the dead man. He communicated because he put his fingers in his ears and he touched his tongue, but still ain't nothing happened yet. Because Jesus is showing us that no matter who you are and no matter what you're going through, I know how to communicate with you. And what you're dealing with won't stop my communication to you. So he puts his fingers in his ears and touches his tongue. And what Jesus is literally saying to the deaf man is this: your life is getting ready to change. Jesus is telling the man, things are looking up.
Lord.
Things are getting ready to turn on. Because your hearing is getting ready to come. Your speech is getting ready to come. He puts his fingers in his ear and touches his tongue to let the man know, you ain't going to be like this after I finish with you. Jesus literally encourages this man that guess what? Your condition is getting ready to be dealt with. And I may not be talking to everybody, but I'm talking to somebody who needs a word of assurance to know that my life ain't gonna always be like this. That the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God that's standing here talking to this deaf man, has power to deal with my situation. Is there anybody here who can lift your hand and be encouraged that things are turning around? I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how, but God is going to turn it around. My sickness has to go. My pain has to go. My disability has to go. I will not stay the same. that don't mean I can't have faith. I know his will must be done, but that don't mean I'm supposed to sit here with my head down and cry and talk about he gonna leave me like this. It doesn't matter what he does, as long as I know he's got the authority and the power. If he don't heal me, he'll give me the strength to bear and endure what I'm about to go through. Jesus, he assures the man that things are getting ready to change. And I know I gotta go, we gotta go. But it bothers me that some of us don't understand that I may not have anything but my faith, but I can't lose my faith.
All right.
And I cannot, I'm sorry. I just believe that God has the authority to literally heal anybody.
I know.
And I'm sorry, some of us don't believe it. Some of us have accepted it. Let me tell you something. You know, I know you got issues, but your problems really aren't anything to God.
All right.
And I guess what I want to say to you is this: whatever you do, don't lose hope in the fact that God can do it for you.
Amen.
What I'm trying to say is this: no matter how long and no matter how far God allows your situation to go, don't ever lose your hope. Believe that God can do it. Have faith to believe that on any moment, whatever's wrong, he can make it right.
Say it. My Lord.
He touches his tongue. Jesus encourages him. He said, we see the intercession of others, we see the intimate care by Jesus, but then we see the immediate results of the word. After he put his fingers in his ear, and after he touched his tongue, Jesus sighed. And the sigh, that's why I don't like to skip words. The sign is symbolic of the fact that Jesus cares.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
And I don't know who I'm talking to today, but you need to recognize the fact that Jesus cares.
Amen.
Jesus cares. See, a lot of folk don't go through nothing. Some of y'all don't have midnight moments. Some of y'all don't have 3 o'clock in the morning moments where you're just crying and don't even know why. Some of y'all don't have midnight moments where the pain in your heart and in your life is so great you don't have nothing to do but cry. Some of us don't have the pain of going to the doctor only to hear the doctor say, ain't really nothing else I can do, you just gotta live with it.
Not all.
So you ain't never had those kind of moments or those situations, you don't understand what I'm saying. But it's good to know that in the midnight hour, when I'm by myself, when tears have filled my eyes and I'm discouraged and feeling down, it's good to know that Jesus cares about me. And then Jesus says, be open.
Amen.
That's what he said.
He says, be open. Why would Jesus say anything to a deaf man? He couldn't hear him. He couldn't hear what he was saying.
Say it.
He says, be open.
My Lord.
Watch this. Immediately.
Immediately.
Okay. I try to teach y'all to look at the words. He said, be open. And immediately.
Say it, preacher. Say it.
Oh, Jesus.
All Jesus did was say two words. Be open. Since I met stuff. Lord have mercy. Please release some stuff. Do I have anybody here? When I wasn't saved, I couldn't say nothing. But since the Lord came in and I met Jesus, I now have a praise that I didn't have before. We see the intercession for others, the intimate care of Jesus, the immediate results of the word, but then finally we see the final instructions of Jesus. This man is talking. This man can hear. Jesus says, don't tell nobody. But the man couldn't help it. The man couldn't help it. But not only could the man not help it, but as the man enters into the crowd of folk, they saw a different person. Lord, person. When he went back to the crowd, he wasn't the same man.
Safe, safe.
And the crowd couldn't believe it.
Amen.
They were astonished. They were amazed.
Yeah.
So much so that they literally said, he does beyond Jesus changed my life. Can't you see some of the crowd going back home? When they got back home, can't you hear a wife asking her husband, how was your day? The husband said, well, I was sitting in the crowd. There was a man who couldn't hear and couldn't talk. But when he met this dude named Jesus, Jesus put him off to the side, put his finger in his ear, put his hand on his mouth, and that deaf man's ears opened up, and his mouth began to speak. I can't believe what I saw. I've seen many things in my life. I've seen the lightning flash. Testimonies from the crowd as they others and those that remain and have been set free shall be caught up to meet him in the air. I beg you to lift your hands and shout, I'm free. Thank you. Hallelujah.
You preach that. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you for your word, Lord. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus did.
Yes, he did. Hallelujah. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Lord.
The problem I have with some church folk, some church folk don't want to admit he was Bible. And by not admitting you're bound, you were bound, you are bound.
You're still bound.
Should nobody in here feel so comfortable with the person you are today? Knowing who you used to be yesterday.
Oh, Jesus. What a word, what a word.
And it ain't even rational. You can't even think of a reason why you would be the way you are today other than to say Jesus did.
There is power in the name
Yeah. favor. Lord, have mercy. I want you to put both arms around somebody. And I just want you to tell them, be free in Jesus' name. Come on. Come on, put your arm around somebody. So tell them, be free in Jesus' name. Come on. What you waiting on? Be free. Here that has never met Jesus Christ as your personal Savior.